Okay, repeat after me. Paper clutter is not scary. I can quickly and easily set up a system so that it is no longer an issue in our household. Well, hi, I'm Dawn from The Minimal Mom, where we love to share tips and tricks so that you can simplify your house quickly. And I am a former paper stacker, right? Like, we used to have stacks of paper everywhere on the counter. Like, if someone was coming over, what do? You stack it up and you shove it somewhere, right? And so we had paper everywhere. But it is an area that we have been able to get control of, and it doesn't have to require a lot of brain power, a lot of in-depth organization. I know for me, I just don't get a kick out of setting up file folders and labeling them and all of that. I know there are people who are, like, that's my mom and my sister, but for me, I am like, shove it in a bin and let's get on with life, right? And so what I wanna do is take how we're gonna tackle all of the paper clutter in our house and split it into two different videos. So today we're gonna talk about how you can really quickly and easily set up a new system for paper coming into your house and how you're gonna manage it here in the new year moving forward. And then in the next video on Thursday, we're gonna talk about taking all of this existing paper clutter that you already have and how we're gonna organize it and get through it very quickly. But I think it's important to set up the new system first, because I think that's gonna be really helpful when we go back to organize and distribute and to decide what to get rid of with our old paper clutter. And so today's gonna be all about setting up a very practical, manageable system. Here is my one disclaimer though. Paper clutter is very unique to you and your family or your household. We all have different things that tend to bring in a lot of paper. For some, it's medical bills. For others, it has to do with school records. Some of us have kids that make tons and tons of artwork. It looks a little bit different, but the overall principles are the same for all of us. So just take these ideas and retrofit them to you and your household and the specific types of paper clutter that you have to deal with. So let's get started setting up a successful system. So the first thing that I think is helpful to do is to divide paper into three different categories. So we have our action items. These are the things that come into the house that we need to take action on. And then we have our reference files. We need to have these within reach so that when we need to refer to them, they're there. And then we have our records. This is the stuff that goes more into long-term storage, so it doesn't have to be as accessible, and eventually it works its way into a more permanent storage location. So let's go through each of these and talk about how we're going to set up a space for them in our house. So the very first thing is action items. So these are the things that come in that you have to do something with. It could be a wedding invitation, a birthday card, a kid's sports schedule, a permission slip, a bill that needs to get paid. Some kind of action needs to follow up, as opposed to something that might come in and that can go straight to being filed or recorded in another way. And so action items for most people need to be somewhere visible. Otherwise, we forget that they're there. And so for me, I have my clipboard system above my desk. I have a whole separate video about that that I can link to. But other things that work well to organize these action items can be wall organizers, over the door organizers. You can get some simple stackable trays like this from Walmart or Amazon. And like I said, usually we wanna put this in a place in the house where we can see it. For me, having a to-do folder or an action file or folder that's put away somewhere in like a filing cabinet or a filing bin, I would never actually do anything with that. So that doesn't work for me. For some people it does, but not for me. I need to have it visible. And so for this, you can divide it into whatever kind of categories that you would like. And let's also remember that the system doesn't have to be perfect. In fact, there is no perfect paper organization system. And I know that because I have tried just about every system out there trying to find the perfect system. It simply doesn't exist, and there's never gonna be one that does it for you. So even as we set up these spots for our action items, we still then have to have a time when we're gonna go back and go through them, hopefully weekly, to deal with the things that are in them. And so that shift, that there is no perfect system and that I'm still gonna have to work whatever system I put in place, has made a big difference. And I don't worry so much now about how I'm setting up the system, but more about how I'm maintaining it. Okay, so next is reference items. Now, often these things can actually get stored in your phone, so it might be things like schedules for sports or different activities, different places that you work or serve. It could be details about an upcoming event, like a wedding or another event that you're going to. Maybe you have to bring something or purchase a gift. It has the venue location. Again, this could all get stored in your phone, or you can create a file for those things. And so, like, here's an organizer. This I got from Walmart. There's lots of different variations of it on Amazon as well. But you could put your action items in the lower bins, and then you could put some of your reference files up here, and then it would be really easy for you or anyone in your household to find what it is that they're looking for. But again, I also, anything calendar related, I think it's good to get into the habit if you're able to store it on your phone. So you decide what's best for you, but often these reference things can actually get stored in your phone, and that might be easier to have it on hand no matter where you are. And then the final category is records. So our tax documents, receipts, warranties, medical records, all of that kind of stuff. So of course you've probably seen these bins. Again, you can just get this at Walmart or on Amazon, and you can put the hanging file folders in it and then put your regular file folders within those. And so this is great. I love the clear bin so you can actually see what's inside. And the key is, if you are setting up something like this, whether you're putting it in a bin like this or actually in a file cabinet in your house, is how we set up the categories for the files that we're going to put in here. Now again, this is where it comes down to personality type, because I know some of you would love the Freedom Filer, and you've maybe seen this online, but it has tons of micro categories. But what's great about it is that it's self purging. And so it works on an odd year, even year system. And so the different categories are assigned odd years and even years, and you rotate. And once it comes back around to the next, like, even year here on 2020, you purge everything that was from 2018, because all of those categories are set up in a way that it's nothing that needs to be kept for more than 2 years. Now, when you talk about other things like taxes that have to be kept longer, those are in their own folder to be kept longer. And so it takes a little bit to set it up, but if you are a micro filer and you like all those smaller categories, you might really like the Freedom Filer system. I'll link to it down below. Now, for the rest of us, I like the Marie Kondo method, where she encourages macro categories, and her goal is to not keep any piece of paper. So everything that comes in, she really scrutinizes it. Do I really need to keep it? And if you've watched my first paper clutter video, I'll link to that down below, but we talk about that scale of easy to hard to replace, and if I needed it again, could I come across it fairly easily? So that one can be a good one for a refresher too. So how we apply that then to our paper categories is we make broad categories. So for example, I put all of my bills paid in one folder. I don't have a separate one for the electric bill and the water bill and the internet bill. I put all of the receipts that I want to keep for the year that aren't tax related, I put them all in one folder. So if there's something I think I might return, or if it's attached to a warranty, that goes in my receipts and warranties folder. Obviously, all of my tax stuff goes into the tax folder. And then I also have a broad category for medical, and then just a general folder. One is for Tom and one is for Dawn. I'll list out these categories down below too. But what I try to do is, as I'm going through paper, everything just goes into one of these categories, and I don't make additional categories throughout the year. Because what happens, and you've probably experienced this before, is that I forget that I made a folder for it. If I make a micro folder, I forget that I made it. If, for example, when we replaced the windows in our house, if I would have made a folder just for our windows, I probably would have forgot about it when I went back to look for those receipts. However, if I just have one general home improvements, or even home reference folder, we're making a lot of improvements right now, so I make a home improvements one, but just even a home reference folder, then I know that most likely it's gonna be in there. The other thing I do is I put the year on here. So again, it's meant to be self-purging. So as we're transitioning over from 2019 to 2020, I'm pulling out my 2019 folder. I'm gonna archive it for 1 year, because the general rule of thumb is that you keep any kind of utility bills paid for one extra year. And then I can now confidently get rid of my 2018 folder and just keep my 2019. And so the idea behind putting the year on it is, again, that it's self-purging. I'll keep these things for 2 years, and then I can get rid of that whole folder or shred that whole folder. And so by doing this, by making macro categories with the year on it, it becomes incredibly easy to manage this. And to when I'm filing, I just put it into the closest category. And so I'm gonna put some general guidelines down below for how long you should keep different types of records. But this has been a game changer for me. We've been doing this for a few years now, and it makes filing very easy. It makes it so I don't dread doing it. I never get a big stack on here of stuff to file anymore because it's just so easy. It's easy for Tom to do it too, and for either of us to find what it is that we're looking for. Two last kind of random categories I want to cover real quick are coupons and gift cards and kids' artwork. So we just use an accordion little folder like this for our coupons and our gift cards. And so often it stays on top of the fridge, but then we can also grab it to take it with us. And I'll just flip through it occasionally to see what gift cards we have to use up or coupons if they've expired. We honestly don't use a lot of coupons anymore. But this has worked awesome just so we know that they're all in one place. It's easy to grab and see what it is that we have. Kids' artwork, oh my, this, I have a whole video on this. I'll link to it down below. But my biggest encouragement to you is to create a boundary for it. So I know a lot of parents use this, whether you actually like put file folders in it and divide it up, or you literally just put the artwork into a bin like this. But to remind our kids that, okay, this is your artwork bin. Everything you keep has to fit in here. So if you add something new and it's full, then we have to take out the old stuff. And I know artwork isn't always easy for kids to part with, but I want to encourage you that I think this is worth figuring out a system that works in your house, because this is an area where we can help to teach our kids how to manage inventory. Our kids are going to be faced with even more stuff than we are, most likely, right? So if we can start to teach them now, unfortunately we can't keep everything, but we can keep your favorites or the best of the best. I think that could be a very helpful skill for them to have moving forward. Of course, also having a place in your house where you can display artwork rather regularly too, I think is really helpful. So it's almost physically impossible to cover everything paper clutter related in one video, but my biggest encouragement to you is that there's no perfect system. What you set up does not have to be perfect. The biggest thing is that it's something that you can maintain moving forward, and that you do schedule time throughout the week to go through your action items. So I would love to know what works for you. Where do you have your action items set up? What kind of system do you use? Please share that down below. It's so helpful for others to read and scroll through. So thank you for sharing that. But coming up in the next video, like I said, we're gonna talk about existing paper clutter and how we can get through it very, very quickly. So that will be in the next video. But as always, a thumbs up is the best compliment you can give us. I hope you subscribe, because we still have a lot more decluttering to do this month, and I'll look forward to visiting with you again soon.